Hey, all you coon hunters, speak to them, Pete. Man, just listen, what a jaw on a dog.
Hello, this is Jimmy. There's no one at the phone right now, but I'll be back shortly. As you know, you gotta really hunt for the good life. Now, if you have a message, if you'll leave your name and phone number, I'll get back in touch with you. You can leave your message at the sound of the beep, and I thank you for calling.
That's it. We have strictly got a home on wheels.
Yeah.
I say free-going man, seems like everybody's asleep. Sound like it. You know what I mean. Not too much now, just cut it off. One more time.
I was born way down in the Southland.
That's good. Yeah, somebody do that.
Hey, Bluegrass Music. Make welcome from Nashville, Tennessee, Jimmy Martin.
Here comes your song, buddy. You got your me and Ralph Stanley on your head. You might as well get ready to put mud in that head when I get through with it. I was born way down, Lord, in the Southland.
Woo! 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 Woo!
Hang on, children. I ran away for the first time. I was 4 years old, I'm a free-born man. My little home is on my land. I know every highway, every foot of back road, every mile of railroad track. Got a gal in Cincinnati, got a woman in San Antonio. Said I would love a girl next door, but any place is home. My little home is on my back. I know every...
Jimmy Martin was born and raised in the farming town of Sneedville in the hills of eastern Tennessee. There he grew up fascinated by the sounds of the weekly broadcast of WSM's Grand Ole Opry. With the 50,000-watt clear channel, the Nashville-based Opry reached households from coast to coast and has long been the pinnacle of the live country music radio shows.
That's my first guitar that I ever had. I listened to the Grand Ole Opry, and Prince Albert was their sponsor.
She's long, she's tall, she's 6 feet from the ground. She's long, she's tall, she's 6 feet from the ground. She tell her man, Lord, Lord, but she don't hand me down. Oh, lay.
Bob, how you doing?
I'm up in Iowa freezing my butt off.
Freezing your butt off?
Yeah.
Well, now, it's not too warm here.
Well, how you been doing?
Have you had a good winter?
Yeah, pretty good. We did okay. How you been doing?
Well, I've been doing great. Been doing a lot of hunting.
The real thing I want to know is they're putting Dr. Ralph Stanley on the Grand Ole Opry as a member, and I'm wondering why can't they do the same for you?
Well, I don't guess they want to. You know, I ain't got good enough yet. What do you think about
it? You mean you still got to practice after 50 years of playing?
Well.
Maybe the Grand Ole Opry and their new manager ought to reconsider.
Yeah.
and maybe make a phone call to Jimmy Martin and say, Jimmy, would you like to be on the Grand Ole Opry?
You know what I'd say?
Would you tell
me? No, hell no. I don't care nothing about being on the Grand Ole Opry because I don't want to be on the Grand Ole Opry. I hear it that it's going down. Look here. It is what they say. And if I can't be on it and help the Grand Ole Opry and them pushing me around and making me look like I'm a nothing, just go right ahead. I am somebody and I'm living good and doing anything I want to. I'd say I just don't care about the Grand Ole Opry. I love it. And I love what it's done with Hank Williams, Bill Monroe, and Lester Flatt and Earl Scruggs. But they've treated me so bad that they could just take and go on down to the dogs if they don't come back up tree coons and rabbit hunt with me. That's it.
It's kind of like keeping poor Pete Rose out of the Hall of Fame in baseball. Pete Rose was one of the greatest ball players that ever was, and Jimmy Martin's one of the greatest bluegrass musicians that ever was. They should have already put him in the Opry, and I'm saying that I'm on the Opry. Should have made him a member, and I feel that they cheated Jimmy out of that, and I just don't think it's right.
Jimmy is the kind of entertainer that made the Opry. He doesn't just drape himself around a microphone. I mean, there's something going all the time, and Jimmy was always different from the herd. He's always been a rebel. He's been a renegade all his life.
Jimmy always wanted to have a show, you know, rather than just four dead guys up there like posts. The old style bluegrass thing where there's three or four guys standing around looking at each other, you know, and playing. That's not where it's at with Jimmy.
He can have a audience in the palm of his hand after the first verse and the chorus of a song, quicker than anybody ever seen in my life. And they'll hang right there with him. He just got that knack.
If ever I get back to that state of Tennessee, I tell you there'll be no more roaming for me. That ill sweetheart said she'd marry me as soon as I get back to that state of Tennessee. Tennessee,
Tennessee. I hear you calling me.
I hear you calling me. The
A lot of people think this is really strange, and this is really strange. When I first heard that Jimmy Martin had put up his own tombstone, everybody that came to Nashville, this became an instant part of my tour. I brought countless people out here. As a kid, Lester Flatt told me that Acuff's tombstone went up, you know, 30 or 40 years before he passed away, and he used to bring flowers to his own tomb. But nobody talked about that. There was no controversy there. This caused a stir.
In the beautiful hills, way back in old Snaidville, there's where I have grown.
Our next little place we come to will be my hometown, Snaidville, where I was born and raised. This little old valley sure looks good up through here, don't it? Brings back a lot of memories.
We always had to work about 6 days a week, get off on Sunday after feed the hogs of a morning, walk about 3 miles back through the woods to Reuben Gibson's. He's the only one in that country that had a guitar and let me play it. He learned me the chords so I could learn to play and sing. Me and Dwayne Wilder and Ralph Hurley with the guitar and the mandolin got us a good trio. On Sundays, you'd catch us in the shade of an old apple tree somewhere on the side of the road.
My dad passed away when I was 4 years old, and I don't remember too much about him. My mother always milked the cows every morning at night and churned the butter. A lot of the food that we eat during the winter, she'd can it during the summer. She was a real hardworking woman. My granddad Martin would often sit down in the swing on his porch when I'd go down and visit him and tell me about my dad. Love my granddad sitting around telling me all that.
All the good times have passed and gone. All the good times are over.
This was the last house that I lived in when I put my guitar on my back and started walking down the road, thumbing me a ride. Stopped by my granddad Martin's, borrowed $10 off of him to go to Morristown, Tennessee and get me a job in a factory. Then I got fired on the job. I was singing too much and everybody said I couldn't sing. So they fired me for singing on the job. So I went down to the Grand Ole Opry and met Bill Monroe and sung a couple of songs with him, and he hired me. Then I went back to Morristown, Tennessee and thanked the man for firing me, told him he could listen in on Saturday night and hear me on the Grand Ole Opry with Bill Monroe. Things kind of look sad around here. Old house just don't look the same. It looks like it's now had its best days, don't it? Of course, my grandpa's been dead for a long time.
Bill Monroe is one of the most important musical figures to ever come through this town. I mean, he came here with kind of an unfinished style of music. And the defining moment to me was when he had finally stacked up Lester Flatt and Chubby Wise and Cedric Rainwater, but the defining moment came when Earl Scruggs walked in the dressing room and tried out for the gig and got it. Lester was really a crooner. I mean, he really was one of the greatest lead singers that's ever been. Lester really made the mold, and he set the bar for most bluegrass lead singers. If you fast forward that thing we call bluegrass music to when Jimmy Martin came to the band, he put a whole new spin on what being a lead singer in the bluegrass boys meant. There was a drive and a lonesome sound that he brought with him, and I think he really took Monroe's music from that original blueprint to a whole new place.
Jimmy was a whole different style of guitar player than Lester Flatt, who was a thumb pick, finger pick type of a player. And Jimmy was a flat pick player. Jimmy Martin had a drive and a tone on his guitar that no other guitar player has got. Absolutely can push you, can make you go where he wants you to go with his guitar.
The tone of my voice was a long ways from Lester Flatt and had to sing them in a higher key. So songs that him and Lester Flatt would do in a G, while me and Bill would move them up to A, which would give it a higher sound. And anything that him and Lester do in A, we'd move it up to B and C.
He fit Bill vocally to a T. And if it changed for the good. Because some of the greatest stuff that Bill Monroe ever did was done with Jimmy Martin.
Mother left this world of sorrow, and her home was silent and so sad. Dad took sick and had to leave us. I have no home, no mother nor dad. There's a little lonesome graveyard on these tombstones.
Get in there, Dolly. Get in. She is in there. Get in there, Rambo. Come on, Lily. Get in there, girl. Get in there, girl.
Let's go check them out, boys. Something up there.
Hey, Jay.
Yeah, man.
Hey.
Sally.
What do you think about that? Looks like they've got him.
They've got him. They've got him. Just hang loose here a minute. Let them have a little fun. Get in there, Rambo. If he whoops all of them, we'll know he's a good one.
Come here to see how good a shot you are.
All right.
Where you want that coon hit at?
Where I want to hit him?
Yeah.
Well, you know where to hit him, Jay.
All right, tell me.
Hit him in the round brown and get him on the ground for the hound so we'll have a good fight.
All right, then. Let's see what we can do with
him. Oh, bust him right there. Can you see him, buddy?
Yeah, I think I got a little bit of a shot on him. Oh, what you got?
I popped him.
Get him, dog!
Lay your gun down, time. Let's get him in the truck, boys.
Has everybody enjoyed the good old bluegrass picking and singing up until now? Let's hear from you, have you? Well, as I always say, I hope I don't come out here and spoil the evening for you. We've had some requests and we've had some not requests. So, do what? What'd he say?
He said he's gonna talk to you.
He's gonna talk to me. One jackass at a time, buddy, and I'm him right now. Don't start arguing with me if you want to play horse and meet me around the back, and I'll be the head and you act natural. I'm all wound up tonight, eh? Woo! I used to sing this to my wife when I was married. Now all I've got to sing it to is my old girlfriends. There'll come a day when you're old and gray, when all your friends have strayed away. Then I'll look at you and say, you hate it, but it got away. Got it, you better save it, save it. Got it, you better save it, save it. Got it, you better save it, save it. Maybe I might need you someday. Talking around, stop your pain up the town. Change away from what you did. If you don't stop, you'll flip your lid. God,
in 1954, after 5 years as Bill Monroe's lead singer and rhythm guitarist, Jimmy left Monroe's Bluegrass Boys. Ready to establish himself as a frontman, he teamed up with Bobby and Sonny Osborne to form Jimmy Martin and the Osborne Brothers.
I was already offered a job with RCA Victor and Decca Records when I left Bill Monroe. All I had to do was just get a good band. So that's how I started me and the Osborne Brothers. When we teamed up, we went to Detroit with Casey Clark and the Lazy Ranch Boys. Wouldn't even standing room in the auditorium every Saturday night. People come to hear us play and sing.
20/20 vision and walking round blind.
In the early 50s, Jimmy started dating Barbara Gibson, an Asheville woman he met during his time with Bill Monroe. They soon started a family together, and Barbara began helping Jimmy with his solo career. By 1955, Jimmy and Barbara had two boys, Timmy and Ray, but the relationship was stormy and often on shaky ground.
20/20 vision and walking round by.
Let's see where this is from. This is from one we got today from EMI. Let's see what song that was about. Let's see. That was Losing You Might Be the Best Thing Yet. And that's one that Paul Williams wrote when I busted up with a woman that I lived with. We recorded that back in 60. That's some royalties from foreign countries like Japan and Germany, Italy, Sweden, Switzerland, all them foreign countries. My records sales pretty good over there. This is a check here from University Group West. I think it says $1,103.08. That'll kind of help me pay my electric bill. I don't think I'll have to play the Grand Ole Opry on Saturday night or Friday night to get a little bit of money to pay that bill, do you? Let's see where this one's from.
Traveling down this long, lonesome highway, I'm so lonesome I could cry. Memory of how we once loved each other, and now you are saying goodbye. On and on I follow my darling, and I wonder where she can be. On and on I follow my darling, and I wonder if she ever thinks of me.
Like when I tried out for Bill, he said he wanted me to go along a week with him. Said we work hard and it's rough, I want to see how you like the road, and go along a week and see how rough it is. Well, I remember what I told him when I got back. He said, what do you think? I said, well, it's a lot easier than digging a ditch or plowing behind a horse and hauling hay to the barn and hauling manure from the barn and putting it on the back. I said, I believe I'd rather pig. So when I got back, about 10 o'clock Saturday morning, he looked at me and said, if you want to work with me, you got the job, just go home and get your clothes.
On and on I follow my darling, and I wonder where she can be. On and on I follow my darling, and I wonder if she ever thinks of me.
Well, that's a big mountain. Better slower on down there, Chubby. That's a steep hill there. Better get on down that low gear. Hey, hold her, Chubby. Don't you run us off in this big holler. Boy, getting to Ralph Stanley's special is the damnedest thing I ever seen in my life. I don't see how poor Ralph got out here with his banjo, do you?
Well, it's pretty bad.
Sir.
How you doing?
Right. Boy, it looks like we're going to have a lot of fun around here today.
I'll give you a boxcar wheelie before I go.
Let's hear it. From the great Atlantic Ocean to the wide Pacific shore. To the queen of flowing mountains over the Southland by the shore. You can hear the hum of the engine, hear that lonesome hobo's call. You're traveling through the jungles on the Wabash Cannonball. Yeah! Do it one more time. If I ever record that, I want you to do that for me.
Okay.
One more time. Got my hat set looking good.
Huh? I'm sorry, Johnny. I'm sorry. Boy, you're wild tonight, ain't you? I don't like you.
Looks good, don't you?
Thank you, Dime, my blue eyes with the Stanley Brothers. Hey.
Give a great big hand to now a star of the Grand Ole Opry, my friend Ralph Stanley, would you?
Sure. Hey.
Yeah, I guess everybody, you know, in the music business looks forward or would like to be on the Grand Ole Opry. Well, I would say it's just prestige, you know. I've been in the movies and everything, but I still respect the Grand Ole Opry, and that was one of my highlights, is to get on the Grand Ole Opry, because it's a music show that's been going so long, and there have been so many great people here on the Grand Ole Opry.
I can say tonight that I'm getting to sing with a star of the Grand Ole Opry. Yeah. A lot of them won't sing with me, but Ralph, Ralph does. So Ralph, I'm glad you're down there, and I'll listen to you and watch you on TV every time you're on. I want you to know that, and listen to you on the radio. And I'm glad you get down there where you can show Porter Wagoner and Bill Anderson and all them guys and how a good old mountain music sounds.
Appreciate that, Jimmy.
I do.
Yes, sir.
I'm glad.
Appreciate it.
You said, do I want it fast? No, about half fast. Wouldn't do for me and him be down there at that Grand Ole Opry together.
Ready?
Ready. There's a rabbit in a log and he got my dough. How will I get him, I know. I'll get me a car and a foot in the car. That's where I'll get him, I know.
I know.
I know.
Yes, I know.
Yes, I know.
That's where I'll get him, I know. Get me a car and twist in my car. That's where I'll get him, I know.
When me and the Osborne brothers split up, I was kind of nervous to a certain extent because I'd worked real hard with them. We had something going that ain't nobody else could top us, I don't think. Then I got a hold of Paul Williams and J.D. Crow. I said, well, I'm going to have to go through all this stuff again. So when I got Paul and J.D., there come the rehearsing, 2 and 3 hours every day till we got her down there just like we wanted it, to get her runs and back each other and where everything fit.
We left Detroit and went to Shreveport, Louisiana in 1980.